Good afternoon. Thank you very much for being with us. It's the European Human Rights course at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. And today we have a guest lecturer, Professor Antonios Kouroutakis. We also have Professor Evangelos Veniselos with us, who also teaches this course. So we are going to have a very fruitful discussion between all of us and, of course, the students who are here with us. First of all, let me introduce the Professor Kouroutakis. He is an assistant professor in a university in Madrid, in Spain, although he is Greek. He received his Dr. Phil in law from the University of Oxford, and he also holds an LLM from UCLA School of Law. He has taught in many universities around the world, for example, even in Hong Kong. He has conducted postdoctoral research in Berlin, in the Freie Universität, also in Sao Paulo, and with us at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki. He teaches constitutional law mainly, but also European law. So today his lecture is going to focus on human rights, especially political rights, in comparison with civil liberties, let's say, with the fundamental freedoms within the European Union. We have already talked within this course about the human rights protection at the EU level. So now we are moving from the Council of State and from the Strasbourg Court, we are moving to the European Union. So Antonis is going to focus on the rights, the fundamental rights of the European citizens. This, of course, there are a lot to say about that. There are a lot to say about, first of all, about the fundamental freedoms. We all know and we have discussed about it, the fundamental freedoms have been from the very beginning the main pillars on which the European Union was built. So it goes without saying that the freedom to reside freely and to move freely within the European Union has always been one of the most important and most significant rights for the European citizens. Something that, allow me to say, a lot of people around the globe would like to have such a privilege to be able to live, reside freely, work, study, etc., within the European Union. Recently, we had the experience of Brexit. So the member states of the Union are nowadays 27, as we know, they're not 28 anymore. And Antonis is going to talk about it as well, because it poses a question, also Brexit, but also other developments and other political processes within the Union, concerning the political rights, the political empowerment of the European citizens themselves. We have also discussed about the character of the Union being, let's say, firstly, a union of states, but not only a union of states. The European Union is also a union of peoples, but it is also a union of citizens. I like to stress that it is, after all, not a double but a triple legitimacy that we enjoy, or we should enjoy, or the European Union should enjoy, based on both states, the government, peoples, which means the national parliaments, but also the European citizens, the citizens throughout the European Union who need to have political rights enhanced as much as possible. Of course, this is a confederation, or for somebody a federation, or there are other teachers of constitutional law who name it a polity or a sympolity, like Professor Dimitris Tsatsos taught us, for example. And within this framework, how European citizens may be politically empowered is really one of the most important discussions that we could have nowadays, especially now that the so-called Conference for the Future of Europe has already started its workings. And the Union asks for everybody, and we would like to also participate to that discussion, to ask our opinions and how things could be better. And better here meaning more democratic and maybe more participatory, more deliberative, and always, of course, the ultimate goal is how we can live freely all together, but also in peace, peacefully, freely, and with prosperity as well. Within this context, I am now about to pass the floor to Professor Antonis Kouroutakis. He is going to present a paper that he has written recently. After that, Professor Venizelos, who is, as you know, Professor of Constitutional Law at the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, but he has served as a vice president of the Greek government and as a minister of foreign external affairs, foreign affairs for the Greek government and in also other ministeriums. But all this experience gives him the capacity, the skill to comment on Antonis' paper, not only from an academic and theoretical point of view, but also from a political point of view. So afterwards, you are going to have the floor and ask questions or make your own observations, because it is very important to listen to young people. You are the Europe of today, but also you are the Europe of tomorrow. And it's really wonderful that we are here with students from all over Europe, approximately from many countries of the European Union. So I hope you will be able to participate, ask questions, and also, of course, say your own view. So, Antonis, thank you very much for being with us. You now have the floor to present your ideas.
And thank you very much, Lina, for this generous introduction. And I would like to thank in advance Professor Venizelos. It's a great privilege to have the opportunity to listen to Professor Venizelos' comments. My paper is written, from my position as an academic. And as an academic, I teach at the university, I conduct research, but I lack the experience of policy making and the difficulties of making decisions, reaching consensus in the political arena. So we hope that actually we will be grateful for the insight from Professor Venizelos. With that said, I want to congratulate Patrick. I think that, no, it's not Patrick, it's Frank. Frank, can you raise your hand? Yes, I can see you. So because he has his camera on, and well done, Frank. So I will, yes, good to see you, Frank. I will kindly ask everybody in this virtual room, to turn on your cameras, because that way we will have a more vivid discussion. I'm saying that because my aim is not just to teach, to transfer knowledge. No, this is not my aim. My aim is to create more questions, because we will discuss about topics that concern all of us. So today, what I'm going to do, I'm going to discuss human rights, but in the discussion, I will bring a number of players. The players that I will bring is first the courts, judges in several countries, they have a key role to protect, safeguard, and promote human rights. And at the same time, I will discuss the dialogue that we have at the EU level between the European institutions and the member states governments. So we will see different key players and how they contribute in this discussion. So the paper is entitled Strong Economic Rights, Weak Political Rights, a Constitutional Cacophony. And with this paper, in reality, I elaborate on the idea, on the concept of constitutional cacophony. I'm sure that you know that sometimes some laws violate constitutional rights. For instance, a law that does not allow people to express their religious belief, this violates their constitutional right, the freedom of religion. A constitutional cacophony is in the penumbra of constitutional law, of constitutionality of the laws. It is a law that, at the face of the things, has problems. It is somehow incompatible with the constitutional rights, but still it is valid according to the constitution. I will give you some examples in order to elucidate the idea of constitutional cacophony. And this example that I will give is the example of the political rights of EU citizens. I will share with you right now the thesis, the main argument that I have in the paper, and then you will see how I build on that argument. So the argument that I make, that I put forward, is that EU citizens, like myself, like you, we have the right, the economic right, to work, to travel and work and freely reside in any EU country. So for instance, I'm from Greece and I work in Spain, I teach in Spain law, and I have the same rights as the Spaniards. No discrimination at all. I'm treated the same way. However, although I live and I reside in Spain, I have limited political rights. In Spain, I can vote for the local elections, and I can vote for the EU Parliament. However, I cannot vote for the national elections. At the same time, some nationals, they lose the right to vote in their home country. For instance, if you are Irish and you move to Europe, you exercise your free movement rights, you have to declare to the authorities that within 18 months, you will return back to Ireland. If you don't make that declaration, you are not allowed to vote in the national elections. So this is the thesis that I put forward, and this is what I call a paradox. It is a paradox because on one hand, we exercise our right, our free movement rights, and on the other hand, we lose our political identity. So this situation became obvious with Brexit. So let me start from the outset. European Union, what is European Union? I'm sure that you have studied EU law in your home country institutions, but the best way to understand the EU institution, as the EU law as a course, is to take into account administrative law and world trade. Why? Because European Union is a union of states according to World Trade Organization. And these countries, they have decided to share borders to create not only a free trade area, but something more robust to create a single market. So in Germany, for instance, we have a number of states, but all of them, they are in the same market economy. And the products more or less have the same price. So if you wanna buy a bottle of water, I see Joanna drinking water. So if you wanna go buy a bottle of water in Munich, or if you wanna buy a bottle of water in Berlin, more or less, you will use the same currency and you know that it's the same price. So this is a single market. So the same is what we try to do at a European level. We want cooperation between states for a number of reasons. But I will state two here. The first reason is that this economic integration will bring more prosperity. If we open the market, we create a bigger market and we will bring more growth in the Union. The second reason is peace in the case of Europe, but democracy. Trade and the opening of trade has the promise of democracy, that if we communicate, if we trade, if we exchange goods, we enhance our economic liberties, and this will spur political rights. That was a promise that unfortunately was not met with China when they entered the World Trade Organization. That is a promise that we are making in the EU, and right now we face some rule of law problems, but this is another topic that we possibly you will discuss later on. So in the EU, we have the four fundamental freedoms Which are the four fundamental freedoms? Can someone assist me here? Do I have any volunteer? The four fundamental freedoms in the EU, the free movement of workers is one. The second one, with Amazon, what do we buy? With eBay, we buy goods. The second is the free movement of goods. So this means that we can sell and buy products without tariffs, the same price. The third one is the free movement of capital. And the fourth one is the free movement of services. So these are the four fundamental freedoms. So EU was built on these four freedoms. And guess what? Suddenly, institutions, national governments, judges, and people realize that we have created a very strong union with these four important rights. However, we lack human rights protection. And this is why progressively we developed and we incorporated in the EU, the European Convention of Human Rights, and we have developed the Charter of Fundamental Rights. In addition, people express concerns. Why? Because the EU institutions, they exercise vast powers, and we, ordinary people, we do not have a say about these policies. Let me give you an example in order to understand how these policies, they have an impact on our lives. So, are you familiar with Donald Trump? Donald Trump is one of my favorite topic. I do believe that Donald Trump made constitutional law very interesting the previous years. And I always enjoy discussing Donald Trump in my classes. So Donald Trump had the belief that America, United States, is losing from the war, global trade. And this is why he imposed a number of tariffs in a number of countries. Among these countries, he imposed tariffs to Europe, especially to cars. So in the US, people fancy a lot BMW, the German BMW, the German Mercedes. So people, they were taxed. They were paying more in order to buy a BMW. At the EU level, Jean-Claude Juncker decided to retaliate. And what did he do? He imposed tariffs on bourbon. Where do we produce bourbon? We produce bourbon in Kentucky. The Kentucky voters are well known because they are Republicans. So these decisions, they have a political dimension. So this is an example in order to give to you how they make decisions, and these decisions, they affect us. Did anyone ask you about these tariffs? No. So in Europe, they realize that we have this deficit, this democratic deficit, and progressively they implemented political rights in the treaties. What is the problem? The problem is that from the perspective of the courts, that the courts, they have been very active. Keep this word, it's judicial activism. They have been very active to enlarge, to protect the economic rights. So we have the free movement of workers. So who is a worker? Is a person who is self-employed a worker? Is a person who works part-time a worker? And who decides about that? And the European Court was very clear in the early 70s and said, well, no, it's not the member states who decide who is a worker, who is a migrant worker. If we allow the member states to decide who is a worker, we will end up to a situation where we will have different policies and the core of the right will be infringed. So we see a very activist court. And we have seen that this court has expanded this protection. At the same time, we have political rights. But the courts here, they were reluctant, and this is here another term that I will give to you, we call it judicial deference. They were reluctant to intervene and protect political rights. So what is judicial activism? If you can note these terms, they will be useful in your future. If you intend to follow an LLM, a master in constitutional law, or if you want to pursue research on these topics. Judicial activism is when judges intervene in political issues, in issues that in principle, politicians accountable to the people decide. Some examples of these sensitive political issues, one of them is emergencies, how to tackle emergencies. There is a common consensus that judges during emergencies, they show deference. Why? Because policymakers, they have the expertise, they have the knowledge, and they make the decisions. The opposite doctrine is the doctrine of judicial restraint, where judges, they do not step in order to protect rights because they have the belief that, well, it's not our role, it's not our cup of tea, and they do not intervene. So in economic rights, they have shown activism, but in political rights, they have shown restraint. And let me give you some examples, the example of Brexit. So in 2016, we had the massive referendum on Brexit. It was in the news everywhere. It was a very important moment for Europe. And for sure that the historians of the future will mention that in the books, in the history books. So who had the right to vote for the referendum? British. People who live in Britain, they had the right to vote in the referendum. What about the British who were living in the EU because they exercised their free movement rights? According to the British law, if people reside abroad for more than 15 years, they lose the right to vote in their national elections. So if you are British and you move, you exercise your free movement rights, and you go to Spain because you like the sunshine there, the weather, or you come to Greece because you like the food and the weather and the people, then after 15 years, you do not have the right to vote in your home country. Interestingly, in Britain, more people had the right to vote. It wasn't only British. It was Irish and citizens and nationals of the Commonwealth. I'm sure that you know that the United Kingdom had the empire, and the states that were part of this empire were part of this, what we call the Commonwealth. So nationals from Australia, from New Zealand, from Canada, from Malta, from Cyprus, they had the right to vote for Brexit. There was a proposal in the British Parliament to allow first Britons who live abroad to participate in the elections and the vote. Imagine that you are a British citizen, you exercise your free movement right, you don't have the right to vote, and then people decide to leave. And then your whole life is ruined, because once you are in Brussels, you are in Spain, and you are EU national, and you are not discriminated against, and you have the same privileges as any EU citizen, after Brexit, you become an immigrant. And you didn't have a right to express your opinion. So there was an amendment to the EU referendum bill, and Parliament voted against. There was a second amendment that proposed that EU nationals who reside in the UK, they should have the right to vote. Imagine that you are a French, a German, Portuguese, and you live in Britain, you have your family there, you enjoy the privileges of the EU citizenship, no discrimination, no extra fees for the university. And suddenly, the people decide and to leave the Union, the European Union, and suddenly you become an immigrant. That was the case of EU citizens, EU nationals who were living Britain. Again, this amendment was rejected. Complaints were brought before the courts. Snyder, a well-known hero of during World War II, who was residing in Italy, he brought a complaint. He brought a complaint before the British courts. And he said that, well, the fact that after 15 years, I lose my political rights, this has an impact on my free movement rights. Because although we say that countries, they shouldn't restrict the free movement of workers, this 15-year rule limits my option. It's an alarm, it's an alarm clock. If you want your political identity, you have to go back. So my free movement as a worker is restricted. The British courts, they ruled on that matter. They decided not to send a question to the European Court. As you may know, the European Court on EU issues is not a Supreme Court. It is a court of reference. So if national courts, they have questions about the interpretation of EU law on a topic that it is original, that it is not clear, they can send a reference, a question to the European Court. And that way, the European system is activated. But the British courts, they decided not to ask the European courts. Snyder followed a different path, and that path was of the European Convention of Human Rights. And the European Convention of Human Rights confirmed its old precedent, saying that, well, who has the right to vote in a country is a matter of sovereignty. And the 15-year rule is a valid restriction because it implies the connection with the motherland. Here, I want you to research and find an equivalent decision from the Supreme Court of Canada. In Canada, we had the same rule. Canadians who were living abroad for more than 5 years, they were losing the right to vote. And the Supreme Court of Canada said that, well, this rule violates their political rights. The European Convention of Human Rights at this stage showed restrain and didn't step in. When we had the referendum, people voted for leave, for Brexit, and the Commission gave the permission to the EU institutions to start the negotiation process about Brexit, about the future, how the divorce will take place, with what terms, and what would be the future relationship between Britain and the EU. At that decision, again, a challenge was brought. And the challenge was that, well, the decision on Brexit violated a core principle of EU law, the principle of democracy. Why? Because an important group of people who are British and who exercise their free movement rights, they didn't have the right to express their opinion. Again, the court, this time for jurisdictional issues, reasons, rejected the claim and said that, well, the decision of the Commission is not a decision that you can challenge. So where do we stand? We stand in a situation where people who travel from the EU, who exercise their free movement rights, they lose their political identity. It's not only United Kingdom. Problem is not solved when British left. We have countries like Denmark, Ireland, Malta, and Cyprus that they do not allow their citizens, their nationals, if they live in another EU country, to vote after a period of time, more or less 2 years. There are other countries like Greece and Germany that do not, or at least at that time, they didn't facilitate the right to vote for abroad. In Greece, we we recently passed a law that requires that people who live abroad, they do not live for more than 30 years and they have a tax ID in Greece in order to vote in the consulate. In Germany, there is a similar rule with a different time period. The EU institutions, and to their credit, they have spotted this black hole, because it's a black hole on the citizenship. And they have stressed to the states that they shouldn't disenfranchise their nationals when they exercise their free movement rights. Unfortunately, this is a very sensitive topic, because nationals in their home country, they claim, "Hi, Antonios, you live in Madrid. You don't live in Greece. You shouldn't express your opinion about Greece." And we end up having every EU citizen who resides abroad without core political rights in the country of residence and limited political rights or no political rights in their motherland. I want you to compare and contrast, and with that one, I will conclude, the similar legislation, the equivalent legislation on the Scottish referendum. In Scotland, in 2015, we had a referendum about whether they will leave the union with the UK or they will stay. Guess what? Who had the right to vote for the Scottish referendum? Every national who resided in Scotland, including English and EU nationals. So this is what I call a constitutional cacophony. Constitutional cacophonies, they are not unique in the EU. I will give you an example. In the US, in Washington, D.C., if you are a resident in Washington, D.C., you do not have the right to vote for president. You do not have the right to vote for the Senate. It is another constitutional cacophony. So this is the concept of constitutional cacophony. And with that example, I try to elucidate this topic. Professor Venizelos, we will be more than grateful to hear your comments and your insight, both from both ideas that you are privileged to have.
Antonis, thank you very much for this excellent presentation. As I understand, your paper is a very coherent argumentation for the need to harmonize and to synchronize the level of protection of economic rights and the level of protection of political rights within the European Union. The real problem, the fundamental problem, is always the historical and institutional character of the European integration. As you know very well, the European integration is a very ambitious political and historical project. To be more concrete and more direct, from my personal political and academic experience, the so-called European integration and also the everyday function of the European Union is a kind of perpetual and endless intergovernmental negotiation. The intergovernmental character of the European integration is something practical omnipresence. And from this point of view, we must respect the role, the sensitivities of the member states if our historical and institutional target is to protect the European integration as the main goal. I'm a pro-European scholar and politician. I am even a European federalist, I understand very well that without the real participation of the member states, it's absolutely impossible to go the necessary steps toward a real future for the European integration. We must understand the complexity and the antinomies of the European phenomenon, the different levels of maturity between the European Union as economic entity and the European Union as political entity, as economic entity, as single market, as financial entity, even as a monetary entity, especially after the last huge QE programs of the ECB, the European Union and especially the Eurozone is a global superpower, absolutely comparable with the United States and also a real player, a real global player. Not the central player, not the epicenter of the global economy, but a very serious partner. On the political level, the European Union is a minor player, always in connection or always under the protection of the European Union. We must take into consideration that from the last stage of the First World War until now, the last century, the European security and the European security and defense policy actually is a joint, a common Euro-American and not just a European problem. From this point of view, we must take always into consideration the real correlation of forces within the European Union, and also to understand and to present the European integration as open field of negotiation. And also we must take into consideration the role of the American administration, because this is my personal point of view. In fact, the United States is a kind of honorary member of the European Union, is always around the table for every critical and especially historical decision concerning the European integration, even for the euro, even for the functions of the Eurozone during the crisis, through different ways. For example, the International Monetary Fund is an excellent instrument for the American intervention in the Eurozone during the decade of crisis. We have, as you know, a very strong and dark domestic experience here in Greece. From a legal point of view, I understand very well your main argument, your main point. Your main point is always the famous European deficit of the European Union. Your fundamental question, your Hamletian question is always who is the sovereign within the European Union? Who is the sovereign? The member states, as the masters of the treaties, as the masters of the European integration, as the masters of the implementation of the Article 50 of the Treaty on the European Union, the European peoples, the network of the electorates in the member states, or the European demos, as you remember very well during this historical discussion, debate concerning the Treaty on the European Constitution, the main question was the question about the construction of a European demos which has the capacity to overpass the national limits and also the institutional role and the national sovereignty of the member states. The historical answer was absolutely negative for this for this position and also for this perspective. From this point of view, we must take into consideration the historical lessons learned by this effort to vote, to impose, to accept, to enter into force a kind of European constitution, a kind of European constitution, not legally, because we talk always about the treaty according to the international law, but as form, as legal form, and also as symbol, because the symbolic role of the constitution, even without a state, the constitution itself plays always this very important symbolic role. Symbolic because the reference is always directly toward sovereignty. But on the other hand, every member state understands very well the famous principle of conferred competences. And from this point of view, we must accept the different levels of the European integration according this excellent and very functional typology proposed by my doctor father and friend and real mentor, Dimitris Tsatsos. We must accept that the European Union is a union of citizens, a union of peoples, but always a union of states. Not a confederation, not a federation. We talk always about a hybrid phenomenon, but we need the member states with us. And from this point of view, we are ready to make some compromises. Without compromises, it's not possible to organize this very delicate and very fragile situation, because every day we must repeat and we must repeat the negotiation and we must verify the European acquis every day for minor or major issues. We must repeat this perpetual procedure. From this point of view, I propose to accept this disconnection between the level of protection of economic rights and the level of protection of political rights in order to protect the European democracy, not as a European phenomenon, but also as a national phenomenon, because the European deficit and the European democracy, as the more cultivated and sensitive version of the Western democracy, of the liberal democracy, is a historical connection between the European institutional edifice and the national constitutional edifice. Now, the main issue for the European Union is to protect the rule of law, to protect liberal democracy from the threat of national populism and also from the threat of a majoritarian democracy without the necessary liberal sensitivities and the necessary liberal guarantees. This is now the priority. The priority is to fix and to protect the European project and not to change fundamentally the foundations of the European project. I accept and I understand very well the sensitivities and also the ambitions of a new professor of the European constitutional law. I understand very well that in our academic discussion, we need a clear typology. We need this harmony between the different level of development, between the European Union as economic, monetary, financial, and also political, military, strategic entity. But this harmonization, historically speaking, it's not possible. And from this point of view, I prefer a honest compromise and not a chaotic situation without internal control, because I repeat my position, and I must underline this remark. The main problem is to give a practical answer concerning the enemies of the liberal democracy on the name of the majoritarian principle, on behalf of the principle of majority as the core of the democratic principle, because this is the narrative of Mr. Orban or of the Prime Minister of Poland or the Prime Minister even of in Sofia or in Bucharest, because now this front, the front against the liberal democracy, it's not only the front from the two big problems of the European Union, Hungary and Poland. We have now a more general and high risk problem concerning the future of the European integration. In the historical core, within the historical core of the European Union, because now the main problem is the situation in France, the threat of the election in the position of the head of the state, so of the president of the Republic, of the French Republic, of notorious Madame Le Pen, and now the first. The first historical duty, even for President Macron, it's not to present excellent speeches here in Athens, in Nika, or in the aula of Sorbonne, but to protect the future of French Republic from this persistent and historical threat concerning the liberal democracy in Europe. This is my first wave of remarks, thanks to your excellent presentation. And I repeat once again my congratulations for your ability to present a very difficult, complex, and sensitive issue with this natural talent of a teacher in the feeling of constitutional law. Thank you, Antonis, indeed.
Dear Professor Venizelos, thank you very much for your comments. What I keep from comments is that the main priority, unfortunately, of the EU is to protect at this stage, not to advance the rule of law, democracy in the Union. As you may know, I'm not sure whether we have any student from Hungary or from Poland. From a constitutional law perspective, some amendments to the constitution, some laws passed in Hungary and in Poland, they are questionable. There is a topic of debate whether they are compatible with the principle of democracy, whether they aim the self-entrenchment of political leaders in this country. So this is one issue. So to protect and not to advance, then I keep the word that EU is a compromise, and the complexity of this project, which is a very important project, requires every time we have a meeting, every time we have a crisis, to confirm the acquis communautaire, to confirm the that we are together, that we are on the same page, all of us. And third, what I keep that unfortunately, EU nationals who lose their political rights, in reality, they are a sacrifice, I would say a temporary sacrifice for the common goal, which is perpetual, which is an endless goal to create a stronger union. So these are the comments that I keep, and thank you very much. I want to make just a comment. I always discuss that in my classes, because we discuss in constitutional law and we discuss the threat of majoritarian democracies where there's no counter-majoritarian institutions. And the way I exemplify that, it's not my words, it's the words of Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Franklin said that democracy is when we have two wolves and one sheep, and they vote on what they will have for dinner. Liberal democracy is a situation where the rights of the majorities have limits, and we need to protect the freedoms of the citizens. We need to protect the rights of the minorities. So this is the way, with the example of the two wolves and the sheep, this is the way I communicate the problem of majoritarian democracies without counter-majoritarian institutions.
Donis, with your permission,
please,
because here we are in the frame of a course of European constitutional law. The constitution itself, as historical phenomenon, as historical acquis, is a counter-majoritarian institution. It is the protection of minorities, it is the protection of the opposition, is the protection of every citizen. The common denominator of the constitution as conception and as a global acquis and global practice is this counter-majoritarian character. A majoritarian lecture, a majoritarian perception of the constitution is the beginning, the start point, the very beginning of the negation of the constitutional acquis. This is the main stake also for the future of the European Union, for the treaties, to interpret and to implement the treaties as counter-majoritarian guarantees. If we understand the treaties as the equivalent of the constitution on the European level, within the European institutional edifice.
Many thanks. Many thanks. I don't know if Lina wants to make a comment or whether it will be whether the students they want to make any comment. I know. I have been at your situation in the past, and I was really hesitant to intervene, to make questions. But it is important to start from here, from somewhere, and start expressing your views, challenge your ideas, because the aim is to ask questions and to leave with more questions after this discussion. So please, if you have any comment, feel free to raise your hand. Lina, I pass to you the floor as moderator.
It's okay. You go to the right direction, Antonis. We're waiting for the students to ask questions or to express their own views. So who would like to take the floor?
Please do that, because we are privileged at this stage, because I see that we have people from different countries. And, you know, this is, you know, the benefit of diversity and different backgrounds being together, where we can see different point of view. So please. So Lina, I leave to you the moderation.
Thank you, Antonis. Diomidis Afendoulis from Aristotle University from Greece wants to raise an issue. Please, Diomidis, you have the floor.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you very much, especially for the lecture and Mr. Kouroutakis and Mr. Venizelos. It's a great honor to be able to actually listen to such a discussion around such an interesting topic. I have a question for both of you, very simply put. Firstly, for Mr. Kouroutakis, on the level of the economic rights being a part of the rights that is such in such a way promoted, and actually judicially we have this activism that is straightforward, would you say that in the paper is something that I didn't manage to understand? Is it something that you're also supporting, that judicial activism should also concern the political rights, and that courts should not show the same restraint, that they have a role to play in regards to political rights in the EU? Because we have several examples. And secondly, because Mr. Venizelos made it quite clear that he historically has seen and believes that it's not possible to reach this level of the European edifice having this political rights of everybody being able to vote, for example, this sacrifice outside of the country. Do you see it as an evolution of the European edifice to reach this level? This is for Mr. Kouroutakis. And I would like to ask Mr. Venizelos, who is such a great model for me reading constitutional law ever since I was a young student, how do you see this major priority of the EU, the problem that we face, the European democracy deficit in Poland, Hungary, and many other states? What is the role of the EU in order to face such an issue? Because it has been something that I've been kept coming back. Hope that it didn't take a lot of your time, and I look forward to listening to your answers.
Antonis, go ahead.
Thank you very much, Diomidis, for excellent questions. The role of the courts goes hand in hand with the idea of liberal democracy and democracy. Professor Venizelos mentioned that the constitution is a limit to any government, because governments, they do not have absolute power. They have the power transferred to them by via the constitution. So this is the idea of constitutionalism. However, in this model, we have counter-majoritarian institutions. And the counter-majoritarian institution that we have is the courts. So in systems where we have constitutionalism, legal constitutionalism, I will explain what I mean with the term legal constitutionalism, we rely and we trust that the judges will step in and they will limit the governments when and if they reach decisions that limit our rights. So if it is about the protection of our rights, yes, I endorse this activism. What is the problem there? What is the problem? The problem that we have is that because judges, they lack the political accountability that representative institutions have, there is a concern. How come and judges, they make decisions about our lives, people who are unelected? And this is, you know, this complaint became prominent in the US when we had a very famous case, the Hodges case, when the Supreme Court recognized the same-sex marriage. People, they said that, well, we have 9 judges and they make decisions about how we live and what do we do. I completely understand that. And we have another model. We have the model of the United Kingdom, which is the idea of political constitutionalism. And the idea of political constitutionalism means that it's not the courts, but parliament and the people who make decisions, and at the end of the day, they protect rights. I'm not sure whether the model of political constitutionalism would work in Greece, in Italy, in Spain. Actually, in Greece, there's a big discussion there about the type of constitutionalism we have in practice, not in theory. But I guess, at the end of the day, I prefer to have judges supporting and enhancing human rights. I do endorse that activism. So it does make sense. Is that clear? So Professor Venizelos.
Thank you, Antonis. Diomidis, the distinction between the so-called judicial activism and the so-called judicial self-restraint stand is a distinction concerning the famous and perpetual problem on the limits of the judicial review. The real problem is always the distribution of powers. The real problem is always a power game between the political organs with democratic legitimacy and the judicial organs of the state. The practical field of this confrontation between activism and self-restraint stance is not the economic rights versus political rights, but the economic policy of the governments. On the level of civil rights, it's very, very difficult to understand the nuances between the two stances. But on the field of the economic and financial policy, the difference is obvious and historical, very critical. As you know, maybe during the decade of economic and financial crisis here in Greece, or in Portugal, or in Cyprus, in Ireland, the confrontation between the parliament, the law, the state, and the jurisprudence, the case law of the Supreme Court, especially of the Council of State, was the main issue. Because we need always the judicial, the final judicial confirmation of a political choice made on behalf of the nation and in order to protect the very existence of the state, the economic existence, to avoid the disorderly default. Your second question concerning Poland and Hungary and this famous confrontation about the rule of law, about the European values, is always an open problem for some obvious non-legal but political and historical reasons. We must make a new typology concerning the member states. There are a new contradiction, this time not between north and south, but between east and west. This is a totally different typology of the member states. And the second criterion is the participation in the Eurozone. There are always problems concerning the European values, the separation of powers, the independence of the judiciary from member states, non-members of the Eurozone, with this specific feeling of national sovereignty concerning also the currency, the national currency, without the restriction, without the constraints of the Eurozone and of this single currency, it's very difficult to impose this perception concerning the need to protect the same values and also in order to achieve a common destiny. This is a differentiation concerning the common destiny. The common currency is a common destiny. And from this point of view, we must make the combination between European values, European integration, single currency, and rule of law. Maybe this is a key concept in order to understand why the problem is always from Poland or from Hungary, or now from Romania, for example. Only Slovakia is a country with some obvious and marginal problems concerning the rule of law. Member of the Eurozone. The unique case of a member of the Eurozone with problems concerning the rule of law. This type of problem, because even in Cyprus or in Greece, we have many problems of rule of law, but not a different narrative concerning the European rule of law. Without intervention concerning the composition of the Supreme Court of or of the Constitutional Court, without this new ideology, new narrative concerning the majoritarian nature of the European democracy.
Thank you both for taking the time to answer my questions. It's really appreciated.
Thank you very much. Anybody else who would like to ask a question or to express your views? How you see things, whether you are convinced by the argumentation of Professor Kouroutakis or Professor Venizelos, or you disagree with something, just feel free to express
your views.
Yes.
Sorry. Hello. Nice to meet you. Yes. Hello. Nice to meet you. It's an honor to listen to you today. On these very interesting topics. And I have a question for Professor Kouroutakis. I don't know if my pronunciation is very well. You mentioned Brexit in your presentation. And do you think that Brexit is an exception, or that other countries will want to leave Europe after the COVID crisis? Because there is a lot of criticism of the European Union regarding a certain economic competition between countries with less social and economic rights than others. So what do you think about that?
Well, Pauline, by the way, because I'm not familiar with who is who, if you make the intervention, can you name the university you come from in that way to show the international character of this meeting? Pauline, from which university are you from?
University of Nancy in France.
Fantastic. And what about you, Diomedes?
I've actually been studying in the University of Aristotle. I will note it down as well next to my name.
Okay. Yes, you mentioned Aristotle, but I didn't know whether you were an exchange student coming from abroad for 6 months, so I wasn't sure. So about Brexit, well, you know, this is a difficult question with the sense that it seems that Brexit is not an event that takes place in a day. It is a process, and it is an ongoing process. And as someone said, that it's like having an omelette and trying making the omelette to distinguish, the eggs, the yellow part from the white part. I'm not sure because I think that Europe has a lot to learn from Brexit. I am one of the EU citizens who believed a lot in the British contribution. The single market, which was further developed with the Single European Act in the early 90s, was a product supported from the British. I have spent many years in Britain and I have learned the British way, and I do appreciate the way they think, and I think that we will miss it in EU level. In political discussion, the vacuum created from Britain, it's a vacuum that Italy and Spain, they try to cover as a third power to balance between the German power and the French power. If Brexit ends up being a very successful project for Britain and Boris, then possibly will lead to more countries to imitate this decision. Professor Venizelos mentioned the threat that we have right now in France from Le Pen. And I'm saying a threat, and I apologize in advance because it's a sensitive issue. Some people, they might support Le Pen, and I do respect their opinions. But the European project, we owe a lot to this European project. The meeting that we have today, the prosperity, the growth that we have in our countries, it happens that the positive incidents, they are incidents that we take them for granted and we neglect them and we focus on the negative aspects. So I want to say that Le Pen, for instance, is a threat for the European project. And I do believe that possibly if we have Le Pen in power, we might have another debate there. So I can't tell, to be honest. I do remember I was in the US in 2006, and I was thinking, well, do you think that change was the motto of Barack Obama, and I was thinking whether a motto like change that we have used in Greece in the 80s will be a motto that will be successful in the US. And I said, no way, it's impossible. And after a couple of years, change was the central motto of Barack Obama. So I'm not good with predictions. So I can't tell. I can't tell. I don't know if Professor Venizelos has better insight.
Brexit is, first of all, an identity problem, not a sovereignty problem. The start point for this major project, the Brexit, is the so-called British exceptionalism. In parallel, there are within the European Union, for example, a Danish exceptionalism concerning the participation in the Eurozone and also the famous parliamentary clause, the famous parliamentary reservation from the part of Denmark. But if your point is the role of the distinction of the member states, the separation of the member states between clear contributors and clear receivers concerning the economic and financial balance sheet between every member state and the European Union as economic phenomenon, yes, this distinction is always alive and very critical for the future of the European Union. This is the starting point for every internal negotiation on an everyday basis within the European Union. in all the institutional levels. The other problems concerning a more specific French point of view is if after the Brexit, France is in position to cover this gap, because United Kingdom is a unique case, permanent member of the Security Council, old empire, the Commonwealth, a country with monetary sovereignty, the real global center of the financial economy, with the possibility to exercise a tangible influence in different critical areas, even in our region here, in the Balkan Peninsula. The British presence is more critical than the European one, officially speaking. From this point of view, the future of the European integration is needed a more powerful and active French Republic, and also a different equilibrium between Berlin and Paris, because now the absence of London from this triangle is something very important and may be very risky for the European Union. The European integration is always at stake. And from this point of view, okay, we have the possibility to go ahead without the historical British reservations and objections, but on the other hand, without the big island, the continent is something different. The continental Europe, it's not the Europe, for historical reasons. The big lesson from the First and for the Second World War, and even from the Cold War, is that the British role is always important, always critical, always vital. The father of the victory was Churchill, and not a German politician in the era. From this point of view, we must open a new debate concerning the political future of the European Union without the British participation, and also in political, at least in political cooperation, without agreement, without a new treaty, without something legally binding, with a new political cooperation between the European Union and the United Kingdom.
Thank you very much, both of you.
So much. Thank you.
And thank you, Pauline, for your question that triggered such a discussion. Is there any other question or anything you would like to share with us? Okay, if not, we can give the floor to Professor Kouroutakis for final words, if he wishes to do so. And then we can conclude.
Many thanks, Lina. I do believe by researching, we change our minds. And by discussing, presenting our research, we improve our research. So I was really, really grateful for from Professor Venizelos, because he gave to my academic paper, theoretical paper, theoretical approach, the practical insight, you know, and the difficulties that we have in the political arena to reach consensus. That said, I do believe that we need to highlight. We need to highlight the imperfect formulations of the European Union. They are imperfect. The EU is imperfect because it is an ongoing project. And I think that whenever we have the opportunity to solve problems, minor or major, I think that it is, and when there is that such consensus, I think that it is great to improve the lives of the people. Although I do support the counter-majoritarian institutions and the idea of democracy, of liberal democracy, I do support that political rights, they are the core of the citizen, of the core of every citizen. And I think that member states, they need to sit together. They need to find solutions there. I will remind you that we had the same problem in ancient Athens. So ancient Athens, which is called the birth, the place where democracy was born, we had the same, somehow the same problem, because Athens was divided into three different regions. And these three different regions, they had a stance to support their king, their part. And Clisthenes, a great reformer of the past, he came and he divided these three parts and he merged them in order to create a unity. Somehow we need creativity, we need smart constitution engineering in order to fix the deficits that we have. So thank you very much. It was a great pleasure. And it was nice to see you, and I hope that it was an enriching experience for all of you.
Thank you very much, Antonis. Professor Venizelos, would you like to say two words? Okay, then.
For me, as you know, it's always a great pleasure to discuss with you, with young colleagues, and also for our excellent multinational audience in this course. Thank you very much for the invitation.
Okay, thank you everybody for being here, and thank you, Johanna. Goodbye, everybody, and see you Tuesday with our normal program. Thank you. Bye-bye.